Yeah.
Aren't you impressed, Nancy?
Yeah.
All of the administrators in all of the buildings. And actually, Tom will go through and explain the whole process of how we're doing this for those that, this is the first time going through this. But basically, we're here to sit and listen and ask as many questions as anyone has and whatever we want answered. So I'll turn it over to Tom.
And especially for new board members, this kind of begins the part of the budget dialogue that really has some values attached to it. We talked about our priorities before, but the budgets have been reviewed, at least internally, in the initial presentations by the administrators, with Pauline and I, and Elaine sat through those sessions. And what we do at this meeting is to take a look at anything that we have in terms of new positions, new programs. And the whole idea is that you get a first look at this, and the first time that you see the new positions that are requested won't be at when we have our budget presentations by the buildings on that full Saturday that we meet. So this is just an opportunity for you to hear what some of the needs are, especially when anything is new. The administrators will speak to why they need the positions. In this packet, you have it broken, you have the same request broken down by location, so what's happening at each school. And that's, I think, the best way to address it is to take a look at the needs of each one of the schools. But then I've also had Pauline break it down on a second page by the impact area program. So enrollment related, regardless of whether it's upon both the high school or middle school, it's broken down that way. Same numbers, just broken down in a different way so that you can kind of get a handle on what's driving the request at each of the levels or within each one of the programs. So this is an opportunity for you to hear all of that, for you to ask questions about that, and it's more of a dialogue, I think, than anything else, but you'll first hear from the administrators in their particular areas.
Quick question.
Yeah.
The
costs include the benefits? Yes. So you get that explanation. And then we're really looking for your questions, what clarifications you need. We're also looking for what additional data you might need. As we talk about enrollment, that's an easy term to throw out, but you might want to really know some specifics about numbers. What are we talking about caseloads? And where do we stand with that? So that would give us an opportunity from now until we present the budgets to you in a more formal sense to get that data so that when we present it to you the next time, we would have all that information to share with you. Also tonight, we'd like to at least preliminarily talk a little bit about the laptops, and Marie's been working with the committee on that, what that means, because that was something that in our budget priorities, the whole technology issue. So we will share some of that information. Also, Elaine will speak to what the town council targets are, and what that means for us. And then Pauline just has a bit of information about the state subsidy in terms of what we were initially told about state subsidy way back when there was the vote on the 1A and the three different proposals, and then what the commissioners recommended budget on how that looks for us. We do not have yet the governor's budget, nor obviously it all has to go through the legislature, and that's a very long and involved process, but at least give you the information that we have now. All that being said, hopefully before you leave tonight, there can be some direction to the administrators. You know, do we need to do something now about this, these staff positions? Because obviously it's a big chunk of money. Would you want us to hold making any decisions on that, just give us the data and then include it as part of your formal budget presentations. That's kind of, before we leave, kind of the direction we'd like to have. If you'd say, well, you know, we really would like you to do something right now about this because it's too much. Or you might say, you know, get us the information, we'll include it as part of the budget presentation. So that's what we're looking for tonight. I want to thank you for meeting a bit earlier, because I do have to, I have to move early. It's kind of my fault for walking early. But I'm sure this is a process that we've gone through before. There are enough people that I'm sure we can get it done. Any questions about the process? Okay, proposed changes. And I'd like to just start by school and have the administrators talk about what they're looking for and why they're looking for the changes and what the needs are. So Pine Cove.
We're starting to start with the teacher.
Yeah, Mr. Air, the teacher, the student support position and the guidance position.
Okay, just so the teacher position makes sense, it's enrollment related and it's sometimes it's difficult to get a grip on the numbers, so I'll pass this out to you. Each year when I do this, we take the students we actually have, and I've learned to average the increase over the average of the past 5 years. We have an influx of students. The hardest number to pin down is kindergarten. I'm using planning decisions numbers from March 2003, which planning decisions is projecting 115 kids in kindergarten. The other figures that we'll read you is current class sizes plus what we get each year. It's been a pretty good guess. So you can see that overall enrollment will be up. It means instead of having 27 teachers at Pine Cove in grades 1 through 4, we'll have 28. The only way around this would be to increase class size, but again, if you notice, by agreement over the past few years and the procedure through the policy, these class sizes are within those realms. It's 18 to 20 in the lower grades, 16 to 18 in kindergarten, 18 to 20, 1, 2, and 20 to 22 in grades 3 and 4. So eliminating a section in any of these would put us over the recommended.
Do you have a number just from,
from
the preschools yet? Do you have your own number as opposed to the planning decision?
It's already up to 80, which is a little high for this time of year. And last year, it's different every year. Last year we had a track, but there was a sudden jump in May. So it's up to 80 now, and this number may be accurate. So for a placeholder, we're putting 3.5 needing 3.5 teachers, I doubt if it'll be less than that.
Right, I'm wondering if it'll be more than that.
It would have to get up even higher than this year as possible. It had to be up to maybe 130 to do that. Okay. But Barbara McLean is on the phone. We've had the ad in the paper, and now we have 81 names. We've got another one too.
So
it'd
have to go to 130?
About that,
another half.
Yeah. So I'm sorry. Outside of the budget process, when would you have to, when would you have to hire a person? In other words, let's assume that just we decide to fund the position. At what point would it be a drop dead, yes, we're actually hiring this person that we funded?
For kindergarten, Kevin?
Yeah.
We knew last year, the numbers got pretty hard in May, so it's right around, I think, the climax of the budget. If we had families move in over the summer, then have to check with the superintendent and go to the school board. It could happen, but we're keeping such careful track that there shouldn't be a sudden jump. It was a steady increase last year.
But this extra teacher's for the fourth grade.
Right.
What about the fourth grade?
We need the regular budget process. We'd have to know as soon as possible, because that's a need.
Those numbers are...
And that's an absolute...
As I said, we've averaged the number of kids we gained per year over the past, it's now 6 years, so it's a pretty hard number.
So you've averaged the kids that you've gained from the first through the fourth grade
right.
to come up with this number?
Right.
And so kindergartner's just on its own.
Kindergarten's on its own.
Right.
So we went back, we checked enrollment to see what happened between June and September or during the year for each grade level for the past 6 years.
So that means you would have 6 kids that would be new that would enter the fourth grade.
Yeah, I mean, you can see it declines. We get almost 15 or so coming to grade one, and it declines by grade four. I've added 7 kids. Six kids. Okay. Oh, you're getting good at this. Sometimes the math is tricky on it. The other personnel needs, a few years ago, I made a proposal about having an ed tech who would be able to support individual kids for periods of time during the day outside of the special education process. We've done it on almost an emergency funded basis in the past, and we've had great success with that. Given that we're getting more kids, we need more particular help, and we have to meet learning results with No Child Left Behind, I'm making a proposal that we add that person to the budget. Claire and I have discussed this at length. It seems to work extremely well, because down the road it saves money for not having to identify kids. When we open school in September, there always seem to be kids either we've had before who need some extra support, or we get new kids who need some particular assistance. I'm looking at this position more as a coach than anything else, somebody to be around, help kids get organized, be available if there's a mini crisis during the day.
Tom, do we have a person that does this now at Pineville?
No, we've had before. I've had to talk to Tom and Pauline about individual kids to be able to do this. So we have a good track record, but it's been on a particular basis. But I've seen a pattern in the past 5 years.
So we would go from no position to a full-time position?
Yes. The only place it showed up before was having a substitute. Mm-hmm. So it would be subtracted from that. But I don't know if you could notice that in the overall budget. I'd have to defer to Pauline whether it show up or not. It may.
Well, would we know who was responsible, you know, like say last year? Like how many times did we need this particular
I can get that for you, yeah. And then I can even let you know, if you encourage me to do it, what exactly this person would be doing. Mm-hmm. How many years have we talked about this, Claire?
Well, just the school year, for example, when the school year started, there was a student that came to our attention right day one. And the referral was maybe special education, but before the testing could be done, the student was really going through a very, very hard time and needed to have a coach. The situation improved drastically. So by the time the evaluation process was done and the PIT was done, it was very apparent the student did not have any emotional issues, but had some behavior issues that were able to be brought under control. The student was not a strong but the student with a disability but really needed that extra coaching to acquire the correct behavior management skills that allowed him to be successful.
And so would the teacher or the ed tech that was with that student, were they with him in the classroom?
Yes, in the classroom and then in the area, and then gradually withdrawn. And that teacher, the ed tech, was able to help other kids too. Mm-hmm.
So how many kids, like just last year, how many kids would you say in a broad range needed this kind of help?
What I'm hearing from the social workers, and I'll talk about it when it comes to my budget, is over the course of the year, there's about 10 students
that's what I was going to say.
Have intervened that were regular students. Okay.
I guess that I would rephrase that question and say, you know, for the next go around, I would be interested in how many students were served last year, whether that was a given 10 students or did it average out to be 10 students over the course. In other words, perhaps we actually coached 30 students that annualized out at 10 based on the amount of time spent.
Well, and part of this would be negative numbers, kids that we couldn't. Right.
Absolutely.
Kids who needed it and we didn't have it, we had to do something else.
And that's the kind of thing I would be interested in hearing a little bit more, not tonight, but, you know, as we move forward in the process, specifically what you have in mind for this teacher to be doing. And one thing you can answer for me tonight is, this is not an adjunct to reading recovery, is it? I mean, is this an additional reading person?
No. No, it's much more generic. It's really, I guess the key word is coaching.
That's what I presumed, but... Thanks.
So this teacher, Ed Tech, we have talked, we've had in the five-year plan for a few years now about increasing the guidance positions again. If that's something you want more information about, I can do a camera presentation that we have. 650 kids, the position's now job shared with two people, and they have the data on how many kids they've seen, how many parents they've talked to, what the feedback is from teachers about classroom presentations. And by numbers, they feel by standards we should have more guidance support.
Might be good for us, and this is not, this comment's not limited to Tom. This is for all of our administrators, and of course I'm not looking for an answer tonight. But I think overall, I'd like to hear a little bit about the impacts, not so much on class size, but on teacher loads and case loads, as we're talking about this. For example, there must be, I'm thinking we've heard from the high school, for example, that there is, and I'm sure Jeff will touch on this, that there is a recommended number of students per guidance counselor.
Right.
Okay, and I know someone will tell us that number at some point. I'm curious, since you're asking for the same, what would that number be? How do we actually compare to that number? You know, in other words, let's say a guidance counselor is supposed to have 200 kids, and our guidance counselors, in fact, have 400 kids each, or an average, some sort of average like that. That's very telling. You know, and it's also a good piece of information for the public to know.
We do that, it's in here. We do have some figures, but again, it's for your consideration. Probably said, well, where does that come from? Or another group might recommend something else. Or maybe I can give you a range of numbers.
Sure. Yeah,
state
exactly.
Guidelines, right?
I'm not looking for right. Specific right. Carved in stone.
Yes. Or the other thing we do is check to see what other schools do in the area.
Yeah, the typical go around. But I think these are things that right. We need to know, our new board members need to hear as well, how those numbers are taken in.
And in the case of guidance, what their responsibilities are.
Because I'm assuming those guidelines are very, very different between each of the schools.
Yeah. We don't do a lot of college placement
right.
yet in Bronco. Who knows? You know?
Could be coming.
Yep.
Not for lack of trying.
Any other questions for Tom?
So the message for me is then pursue. Is more information on the ed tech position and guidance?
I think what we're by the end of the night.
Yeah, I think.
Let's
all right. Let's try.
Trying to get an insurance effort.
These are the heavy hitters coming up next.
Good try.
It is good.
Trying to sneak that right in there.
I did. I won't say that we have the smallest percentage of the overall budget, but, you know.
I just had one other request for some further information on that ed tech. And I know, Claire, maybe perhaps you can explain this a little bit at a later time, but I'd be just kind of curious as to when we don't address these issues, what the consequences
right.
are. And I don't know if
I can talk about it when I get to the, my physics section, but I'll do that.
Okay. Well, ours, first of all, is the world language to increase two tests. That's an enrollment-related issue. Our world language teachers, for the last several years, especially in grades 7 and 8, have taught probably 2 to sometimes 3 of their classes per day have 25-plus students in them. So therefore, the overall effect of teacher load gets compounded as you go through and doing things. So this is 2 tens. It's an enrollment issue. It's also a wonderful program issue in that the vast, vast majority of our students participate in world language. And that's a very good thing. And also, our world language team provides the services to Bronco for grades 3 and 4. And so many times our teacher who may be teaching in grade 3 is also teaching in grade 5. And it usually goes that the person who's doing grade 4 also helps with our grade 6 kind of thing. We work that out and juggle schedules and move things around. The 2/10 will give us a little bit of flexibility there, but quite honestly, the biggest difference it's going to make is in the teacher load for our 7th and 8th grade teachers. So that's the 2/10 for world language.
Nancy, can I?
Yes.
Real quick. On the world language thing, does that mean a new body, or does that mean someone going from?
We do currently have a staff member who's been very successful with us who is at 8/10. And our most likely proposal would be to have that person come on full time.
That would be easier.
If that person currently teaches at grade 6, 7, and 8 for us. So that's great. And has also in the past taught at grade 5, so knows the program quite well, quite thoroughly.
And with this, you said the average in the 7th and 8th grade is 25 per class.
In world language.
Right. So what would that take us down to?
It would bring us, hopefully, more to a teacher load for the world language team to be more in line with what our average is, which we try to get to 112 or 113. Right now, somebody, if you take like a Susan Dana, she has a couple of classes that are 24, 25. So not all 5 of her classes are that way, but several of them. It also, the good news part of this is we have, over the last several years, we have actually added quite a few students to the middle school over the summer. We're finding a trend where it appears that more families are relocating to Cape Elizabeth as their students are in middle school instead of just coming at the earlier years. Middle school in years past hasn't always been a time when there was a great deal of change. This would allow us to make sure that we can have a class that those incoming 8th graders, some of whom who have not done a world language before, could definitely become part of a combination 7th and 8th grade class in the non-target class for that grade level. I'm in 6th grade right now. I've done Spanish since 3rd grade. Next year I have an option to either do Spanish or go to French, and that French class would be the one that all of our new students would go into if they have not studied a language before. And many of them have not. So it would just give us more flexibility in that area kind of thing. The other request that we have for new staff is in our allied arts area, and that is really in response to some programming for our students and some collaborative planning time for our teachers directly related to learning results and assessment. In the middle school, we do not have common planning time for any of our grade level teams. It's been something that it's a part of middle level education. It's very standard in any of the literature that you read about middle schools. In fact, many of our companion middle schools in the area, the teachers not only have a collaborative planning time with their team each day, but they also have an individual planning time. We only offer an individual planning time, and the teachers meet either before school or after school. And this has been a condition that has existed ever since the beginning of the Cape Elizabeth Middle School in 1971. We have members of our staff who've been waiting for it for that long. They're pretty sure they're going to be retired before they see it, but anyway, we're moving forward with that idea. Now we have, it's not only just good middle level education, but with the need to do common assessments, it would give us time so that we could say, out of the 5 planning periods per week, we could ask them to use 1 or 2 to devote to those common assessments. Some they will still need for individual planning time and for time to respond to emails and parent calls. And that's just the fact of survival and communications in school and good education. But we're hoping to do that. Now, the proposal would also, I'm trying to get an element of choice into the allied arts with our 7th and 8th grade students by adding an option there. And yet trying to keep it within a less confusing configuration. I can sit here and tell you what we would need in order to have common planning time for our grade level teachers at grade 7 and 8. We need 8 places for our students to go. We could do that by the 6 offerings we have now and add 2. In order to make it work out so that everybody sees everybody, you have to go from a 6-day rotation to an 8-day rotation. At the same time, you don't need that many rotations in grade 5 and 6, so you have a different rotation for them. Anyway, it gets very completed. So I'm trying to stay with the six-day rotation, simplest form, but bring the element of choice to seventh and eighth grade so that they would definitely take in those 6 days. They would have physical education. They would have music. And one of the trimesters, they would take health. We fought very hard, and you supported us in order to get health education and health educator part-time at the middle school, and that's an important course for them to take. And then looking at during the other two trimesters to see if we could work it so they could have a choice, so they would take any two of three offerings. In order to make all of that happen, we feel we need to add a 1.5 position. Next year in grade 5 and 6, we can get collaborative planning time by offering them just 7 places to be. And so that it's a little bit different, but stay within our 6-day rotation. And I've worked out several different plans. Some of them are more confusing than others. And just at the end of the evening, we'll either figure out it's a noble enough try to keep working with it and see what works out, or not. But it would meet the need. We do need to do the common assessments. We need to find some collaborative time within the school day for these people to do the collaborative assessments. And this addition to our Allied Arts team, I believe, would get us there. Adding, probably right now my thought would be some sort of a drama workshop. And chose that because it gives us a chance to practice several things in common assessments, a performance assessment, because there would be a performance. Also, our student body has shown us by the number of students who have participated in our variety show and in our drama plays over the years that there's interest in that particular area. So it might be, right now today, if I had to propose it to the students, right now at this moment it would be that they would take the ones that I mentioned, the phys ed, music, and health, and then they'd take any two of either art, industrial technology, or drama workshop. And we'd have to see by their choices if we could actually offer that. But
yes, you're going to be actually offering an additional, one additional subject.
Right. At the first proposal I came up with, I had a different proposal, but it actually ended up that people saw some of the students less than they've seen them now, and that's not the way we want to go. And so part of the proposal right now, the most recent one I'm working on, is being able to have larger physical education classes so that there'd actually be, instead of 2 classes going on at a time, more like 3. And I do believe we have the space in our gym to do that, as long as we have the adult supervision and expertise to do that.
Yes, excuse me, using technology, I missed that part.
Right now, the ones I'm thinking will be art, industrial technology, and drama workshop. Mm-hmm. And that, as we investigate this further, that might change. It's already changed from the time that we sat down and talked with it at our budget proposal, from some things we thought we might do. But it seems like a simple thing, but it actually, our schedule is quite complex, and to make it all work, we need to offer things within a reasonable manner and within the time.
And hearing what you're saying is that the more important issue is that this is not feeling particularly a student need or an enrollment issue. It really is a professional development or common assessments, planning time for the teachers.
Yeah, and I would actually, it's not enrollment numbers driven, but it is a student need in the sense that 7th and 8th graders like to have some choices in their lives. And we don't have a lot in our schedule where there are a lot of options and choices for them to do. So this would meet a need that some of them have, and they've had 2 years of the art, and they've had a chance to experience industrial technology, and some of them are just interested in other kinds of things. So giving them some kind of a limited choice, I think, is a good thing to face emerging adolescents with. That makes sense for them. And this would also meet the need, the professional development need for the teachers, and their requirement need for the mandates for Maine State Learning Results for common assessments.
We're facing something all school districts are. Because of the mandates, what we need to do, it's all collaborative work the teachers need to do. Everyone's lining up against it. There just isn't the time to do all of that. Now, some districts have had this, I know when I was in Pomona, to be given, they had a common plan time in middle school plus a personal time. Many schools have that.
Yarmouth has that now, and Falmouth has that now, so they don't have to go far away to see places where they offer that.
So, I mean, it's just something that now that it's law, isn't it, it's just a nice thing to do, we have to do it. In the high school, if you remember, last year, we were working up with a way to get the
right, and the middle school is the only school at this point that we haven't addressed this.
Well, Plant Cove, we have partially. We have a makeshift kind of plan there. But the one that the school is the furthest away from having any kind of help.
This would not eliminate the teacher load. A middle school teacher's common teaching load next year, average teaching load for grade 7 and 8 will be 110 students, which is quite a distance away from our target of 80. But it is lower than our current reality of 115.
It compares to neighboring school systems.
You know, that's some of the information I would get for you, Kathy. I know just in general conversations, they're closer to the 90, 92, some of them. We just had a middle level conference last Wednesday evening, and Yarmouth was there, and I think their common teaching load is 65. They work on teams, and some of the teams have 75. But they're able to do this by a couple of things that we have chosen not to do. They do not differentiate math instruction. And our students, through their performance over the years, have shown us that that's the one place that's good for us to differentiate is in mathematics. And also, world language is taught as an exploratory, and you only take it maybe for a trimester, and they haven't had it for as long, and we have a different kind of program in that. Some of the middle schools also have a life skills program, which we do not have, similar to a home economics kind of program that we do not have. Some of them have full-time health teachers, so the health offering is a little bit broader based than we have. But these are things that we could find specifics about from other places if this is something that from tonight we're encouraged to look more further into.
I would say,
Nancy.
I'm sorry.
Besides the world language teachers, do you share any additional type of staffing with Plant Cove?
We share health teacher.
Oh, okay.
And social worker.
Services.
We share social worker.
That's right. Yes, and we share a social worker in special education.
I think I got the same message initially that Elaine might have. We have, in fact, been talking about this common planning time for a long, long time. Mm-hmm. And it seems to me that that's an issue all by itself. And when you talk about the allied arts piece of it, it sounds like new program. And all I'm saying is, I'd like, you know, perhaps you can work on that, because new program, it's hot button, and I don't want to confuse the two.
I don't want to confuse the two either, but one thing I have to be very clear about, our students have to be somewhere. So if we're going to do collaborative learning time, you have to, and right now we do not have enough allied art slots to send everybody there at the same time. So what we're looking for is an allied arts expansion. The only thing that we really would be adding would be that drama workshop. We already offer phys ed, we offer all the other ones. So that is one way to look at it. And that's a program, and that's why you see it on both the programming list and here. But it's hard to talk about one without talking about the other, because they are extremely interconnected. And it comes down as basically as this. If the grade level teachers are meeting, the students need to be somewhere with somebody. And this will not eliminate the need for some of those early morning meetings for grades 7 and 8, because that's when the advisors meet, and our allied arts teachers are advisors at those two grade levels. And so they would still need to talk about common student concerns.
That's a lot.
So then, Nancy, to what extent would this then offer, would this meet the needs of the teachers for common planning time?
It gives them common planning time, but an opportunity cost if they lose individual planning time.
So they'd all be off at the same percentage?
I believe, my understanding from the high school is they have common planning time and they have individual planning time. That's not what this proposal does for the middle school.
So it doesn't really fully meet the planning needs of the teachers?
No.
This is just a partial?
But it would allow for those common assessments that we need to do, at least there's a moment during a day when we know everybody can meet to go over the assessment needs and whatever.
Contractually, you have to allow a planning period a day, as you said, what planning has to be. So this only puts it, this only helps with the organization of it. It doesn't get,
no, it doesn't, and it doesn't put us in really good comparison status with planning time issues with the schools we like to compare ourselves with. But it does give us some time during the day that the teachers would have in common. Now, if we want all of the, even if it was a laptop issue or a common assessment issue, we have to either get substitutes for everybody or find some magical time. There isn't a lot of that to do those kinds of things. So
your feeling is that other comparable schools have been able to address this more adequately?
They have, but they've made some other choices that we have not made. Okay, they choose not to differentiate instruction in math, so nobody does algebra at the Yarmouth Middle School. I think they have one algebra class. Well, we start algebra as early as seventh grade. Upon occasion, a sixth grader will take algebra. And they don't offer any kind of an algebra instruction until grade 8, and then only to a select few. And that's one way you can free up some things and work on different kinds of team structures if you do that. And also, if we're all in a homeroom, one trimester we might experience French, and the next trimester we'll experience Spanish, and the next trimester we might experience German, just as an awareness.
A different
we teach it language. As an academic subject, and it's a choice we made long ago in our curriculum. And it has shown our students' performance. When they get to high school, it has shown to be some good programming choices for our students.
What I'm hearing you say, Nancy, is this is really just a first step in addressing the issue of common planning time, which is now almost mandated by the mandates that have been placed on us.
And it's one that I bring to you after having thought, I had another suggestion for common planning time, but it involved things like, for instance, every Tuesday, the middle school would start at 8:30. It involves transportation, it impacts Pond Cove, kinds of things, and that way, all teachers at the middle school could have this one gigantic common planning time from 7:30 to 8:20 on Tuesday morning. That has some nice thoughts to it in some ways, but it also, it's bigger than the middle school. It impacts the other schools, it impacts other working divisions, it does a lot of things. And it became maybe a more complex solution than this particular one that keeps it within the middle school.
I'm sorry if this is a basic question.
Oh, no, that's good, that's okay.
You're talking about collaborative planning time, you're talking about during a school day, mm-hmm. a normal school day, as opposed to prior to school and, mm-hmm. and after school. Mm-hmm. And if I'm understanding, Tom, you're saying that there is a contractual responsibility that we do this?
They have a plan.
Okay. Right.
And that's sort of within those boundaries of 7:50 to 2:20.
Okay. I wondered if, I wanted to make sure I understood that.
Now, our eighth grade team meets at 7 a.m. every Tuesday morning. Our seventh grade meets at 7 a.m. every Wednesday morning, fifth grade meets at 2:20 every Monday afternoon, and sixth grade meets at 2:20 every Tuesday afternoon.
Well, I mean, I know I've talked with teachers in the middle school that mm-hmm. were there prior to 7 o'clock, so mm-hmm. I know that
right.
they're not in the window, but
right.
Nancy, how much planning time does this give? Is it every day?
It would be, they'd have a planning period every day. The idea would be, if we're on a grade level, let's say we're on the sixth grade team, mm-hmm. every day our sixth graders are with somebody else from 12:30 to 1:15. So we could all meet.
So it's a 45-minute common planning
minutes.
Time.
Mm-hmm.
And what?
Not new time, either. It's just
no,
it's
I
a
realize
reshuffling
that.
Of time
but what's the personal planning time that they have right now?
That's
That would be it.
So it is a trade for exact trade.
One is the opportunity cost of the other. The thing that for some of the teachers, not 100% of them, but for some of them, they feel, okay, because then if I can always do my personal planning, if I have young children and I need to be someplace with them in the evening, I can take it and do it there with them, off school site, and I can meet, do the grade level meeting during the day when I already have childcare issues taken care of, or other responsibilities, whatever they may be. And that the assessment is important, so we need to give them professional time to do that assessment for.
Yes, this is off the subject, but I'm curious. Does Uganda standard language instruction meet the language?
No, and I'm not exactly sure what their whole total language instruction is. My example of that language instruction is really sort of more of a generic example. I know the math one because we just talked about that in an evening conference, but no, but the classical modern languages is one of the ones that's kind of deferred down the line. So they're going to have to make some adjustments. Right now, a very big topic in middle level education is how to meet all those standards and stay true to quality middle level education. And things like career planning time, exploratories, all of those kinds of things are part of that very active discussion.
Nancy, in terms of middle school enrollment, this will be a question, and I think everybody should hear this. Why, you know, we all talk about this eighth grade class is the largest class that we've had coming up through the middle school, now going into high school. So why will we have the same amount of teachers in middle school?
The actual, one of the things, it would help us perhaps, it helps us move that teacher load from 115 to 110. You'll notice it's not a great drop, but it's going in the right direction. When we're looking for that target of 80, too, and would it be great if we had 90, but that's our average teacher load. And I'll have much more specific statistics for you, see if I can say that tonight. If we go ahead with this, to find out. So that's one of the things. It varies because kids will take different offerings, and we try to keep some of our language arts classes a little bit lower than some of our social studies classes, than some of our science classes, because of the response that we're trying to get to students and where we're teaching them. Probably the biggest place that you'll notice a reduction in teacher load next year would be in grade 5, where my proposal does call for us to stay with our 7 classrooms. Right now we are anticipating an incoming class with people that Tom has on board right now of 129. We currently have 156 fifth graders. But everybody pretty much in the fifth grade right now, the average class size 22 or 23. And by going the other way, we would have 18 or 19. It is our introductory grade into the middle school. We did this a year ago, because then the following year we need to go right back up, and it lets us hold on to quality people and quality programming, and having the 19 class size of the transition year to grades, to textbooks, and to the middle school is not a bad thing, kind of thing. It keeps everybody else just about at the same place. The eighth grade, our current seventh grade is at 152, so over 7 or 8 offerings at a time, you're talking about a difference of 12 students.
But really, that grade grew up.
This grade has grown over the time. And one of the things you'll see when we do our other graphics is that what I'm anticipating we'll pick up about 6 to 8 eighth graders over the summer. There will be some students will leave, but in total, we'll net probably a growth of anywhere from 6 to 8, maybe it will be 4 to 8. But it will, once again, move that right up closer to that 160, and so that has occurred. Currently in our sixth grade, we have 142 students, so that's 10 different than what the current seventh grade is, but you divide that over time, and once again, that's another grade where we probably have the 4 to 8 increase. So pretty soon, and that's been our pattern for the last 3 summers. I have no way of guaranteeing that it's going to be the pattern for this summer.
Is that the current pattern? What was the jump last year from fourth to fifth grade?
This is just what our current enrollment is right now in middle school.
So you don't have fourth grade? Well, you've got...
I believe last year when the fourth grade was coming in, they were pretty much the same size as the eighth grade that we sent, and that was about 146. And right now they're at 156. So that was 10. And that's been the trend over the last 3 years. It seems that more people are moving to Cape Elizabeth. This is their second home. Their families are a little bit more established, and we move on.
Any other questions for Nancy?
Back to that collaborative time. Some of the other models that you've seen in surrounding community that you talked about as far as a dedicated day or a portion of the day, and that you had looked at things like a different start time and that type of thing, those come with a different cost. But they don't necessarily come with a financial cost?
Well, there's a financial cost in transportation. There's a financial cost, there's a cost, and I'm not sure what it does to Ponco. There's a cost in our music programs, because on a day, let's say that the students were ready there from 8:30 to 2:20, there would be a cost on if you would be able to have band or chorus that day, which then is a cost on their practice time. So we may not be able to have the programming that we have now.
The extracurricular programming that goes on early in the
The band and chorus, there's 25 minutes every day where either the band or the chorus is practicing. One day, seventh grade band practices, the same day, eighth grade chorus practices. This is the jazz groups do before school. And the fifth and sixth grade chorus are before school. But the seventh grade chorus and seventh and eighth, those are in school. On a day that we were doing a collapsed schedule, we probably wouldn't have our advisory groups meet, and we wouldn't have band and chorus. Therefore, we could get all of our academics in for that day, that kind of thing. Because our classes are really only 45 minutes long, and if you cut that a lot shorter, you've really, hi, how are you? What did you discover interesting last night? Whoops, time to go to the next class. And that's, we don't want to do that. So that's
the general
cost.
Answer, it comes from student time. We're having a late start on Monday, great and crave and very productive, but that cuts into debt.
So there's a cost there that you have to look at. And it's just the reality. Probably the financial cost might be in what it would do to transportation. The other things are student programming opportunities.
And would a full day out of the school year?
And it actually does it, because when we're doing the common assessments, we need to develop them, we need to go out and practice with them, we need to get feedback, we need to come back and share the feedback, improve upon them, also have time to respond to the students and their work and figure out ways to do some common scoring, so that we're emphasizing, although we may each have our individual styles, we are emphasizing the same standards and expectations. So having one day doesn't do it. It needs to be a continuous, repetitive.
Throw in my 2 cents on
2 cents.
my narrow sort of experience with middle school, because the question about schools with which you compare ourselves, do they have these similar provisions? I can tell you that from my experience, just the two other districts that I've been in, which are schools that we would not compare ourselves with because they don't perform nearly at the level that Cape Elizabeth does. In middle school, the teachers have both common planning time and individual planning time, and then SAD 75, they've had for years a late start Wednesday, every single Wednesday. So just to give you a sense of perspective, I know in the Bath middle school, they've had common planning time, individual planning time, and much smaller student loads for teacher. And just from the perspective of the high school in terms of planning time, the common planning time, I think it's important to understand that developing assessments is one piece of what is required to happen, and obviously that can be sort of a hitter. I mean, that requires a concentrated amount of time and then periodically going back and taking a look at when there are still good assessments. But in addition to that, it's also a matter of using that time to do the common scoring of the work, so that you know that from teacher to teacher there's sort of an even playing field in terms of
way kids are being measured, which is part of establishing the validity and reliability of the common assessment system. I don't know how you would get that done outside. Our teachers will come together and they will come and score. Not every single piece, but enough that you have a real sense of confidence that they're using the same sense of what a 4 is or a 5 is or a 3 is or whatever the measurement scale is. Well, that's true. In terms of the high school, I just want to step back just a moment to 2 years ago, when the high school last had a population increase of about 10% at that time, about 50 students. And the way the budget scenario played out at that time is we had a student population increase of about 10% and a teacher increase of about 4%, I think. So we had a situation where our student population was going up considerably faster than our teacher population, and we made a decision in light of the budget situation and in light of some other priorities that we had that we would do that. But that has had an impact in terms of our ability to respond to a student population increase that we're expecting next year in the neighborhood of 9% or so. About 45 to 50 students is the total increase that we're looking at the high school. It's probably going to be closer to 45, I think, than 50. But the result of that, having a significantly smaller staff increase and population increase 2 years ago, is that we do have less flexibility now unless we want to really completely bust through any sense of what the teacher load, student-teacher load should be. Our class sizes have gone up considerably on average, which means that the total load of students per teacher has gone up. And most of our teachers are beyond what the school board has said is the range that they'd like to see the teachers in. In addition to that, the availability of elective classes for our students has gotten less and less over the last couple of years. Because we're trying to sort of balance out the issue of what's the class size, what's the teacher load in the core academic areas versus electives. And so our electives have not gone up as much as the demand. For juniors and seniors in particular, there's a need to have a certain number of elective classes that kids can fill, because we require them to take 6 classes, and for most of them that's math, English, science, social studies. Many take a foreign language, though it's not required. Many take foreign languages for 4 years, but even that only gets you to 5. So every kid is taking at least one additional elective, and many more kids are taking 2. And as I was talking with Sharon, Merrill, and Belinda Snell, our guidance counselors the other day, and right now we're at the beginning of the second semester. Just this week is the first week of the second semester. It's add drop time. It's changing the schedules times, it's that sort of thing. And there are only 3 classes in the entire, 3 sections of classes in the entire school right now which have any real capacity to absorb kids in electives. Kids can choose to take health forum, there's some spaces in health forum, they can take computer applications, and there's 1 art class. I can't remember which one it is. I just know it's not photography. but there's 1 art class. So there is a real electives crunch.
Is it one art class that needs a prerequisite?
I think it is, actually. Yeah. I believe it is. I know it's not art fundamentals.
Yeah. Yeah.
The increase we're looking at for next year is, on the low side, we're going to have probably about 17 more ninth graders based on, that's assuming we lose a certain percentage from in the middle school going to high school, which happens every year. That's assuming we lose 6 students, which I think is fairly typical. It's possible it would be a couple more or a couple less, I don't know. But that's our 10th grade population compared to this year is actually going down by 9. And then what we actually have with the rest of the increase, it's actually fairly concentrated in the junior and senior years, actually. Our junior class next year will be 15 greater than the junior class is currently. And we are graduating this year a very small senior class and picking up a significantly larger new senior class who are currently juniors. So that population is going up by 22 right now. So we're looking at a total increase of about 45, I think, give or take a few, depending on how things play out. The simplest way to think about that, I think, is that if we take 45 students, or I actually worked at originally at
48, but you can work the same numbers at 45, it makes a slight difference. But at 48, a typical student in the high school, average student, obviously takes about 6.5 classes. Everybody's required to take six. A good number takes 6.5 or 7, and then there's a small, a very tiny number that can take 8. But you can take 6.5 or 7 and still have a study hall in your schedule, which is what many, many students choose to do. So if you take that 48 and you multiply it by 6.5, you get the 312, which is the number of classes that those additional 45 kids will be looking to take compared to the number that we have this year. And then you say, okay, let's take, if we didn't want to increase teacher load beyond where it is right now, and it's higher than it should be under, even under the high side of the school board policy, we take a teacher load of 90, divide that 312 by 90, we get to a total staff in order to accommodate the needs of those students of 3.5 teachers. Right now I'm guessing that I'm looking at 3.4 to 3.6 teachers as an increase for high school. And that's pretty simplistic, and obviously there are things like band and chorus that have not infinite, but virtually infinite elasticity ability to absorb kids. But we know pretty well the number of kids who are going to be going into those things, and it's hard once kids get to high school to sort of funnel them into, certainly band, it's almost impossible to get kids to begin taking instrument in the ninth grade. Of course, we can do it more, and we hope we will be successful in doing that. So there's a little bit of flexibility in chorus in particular, but it's not going to make a significant difference in terms of that number. So that's the number that I look at, just simple numbers, that in order not to increase the student load per teacher beyond where it is right now, that's the number of teachers that we need. There is a significant need for increased electives that are included in that, which is different from the need that we faced actually last time we had a student faculty, like 2 years ago when we had a similar increase. The last time it was pretty much all focused on the ninth grade. That was virtually the entire increase. And depending on the way sign-ups take place, and depending on the way we determine, you know, which kids will be in college preparatory classes and which kids in honors and which kids AP, that can give or take a little bit, because it really is very dependent on how many you get to figure out how many sections you need to address the needs of kids, for example, in college placement, FST, or French 4, or French 5, or whatever it is. And it can, like, a shift of a few kids can make a big difference, particularly in a smaller high school. I've also asked for an additional guidance counselor. I have some information that, in my mind, at least justifies the need for an additional guidance counselor. We, guidance counselors right now have 275. That's their load. Next year, if we do not increase, our guidance counselor will be at close to or at 300. At 275 right now, our guidance counselors are already significantly above what they have, what the load is in Falmouth, Scarborough, Greeley, Yarmouth, just about any place you want to think of. Those are just the places that I've called at this point. The normal range that I've seen, and I've seen different numbers in terms of sort of guidelines for what's what you want to shoot for. I've seen 225 and I've seen 250. I was meeting with Sharon and Belinda today, and they were talking to me about, they want to talk about the students that are coming from schools out of state in Connecticut, Massachusetts, and those kinds of places, where in terms of college placement, our kids are competing with those kids. There's a lot of those schools who have significantly under 200 load for guidance counselor. I've asked for a full guidance counseling position because, for a number of reasons. First of all, I think that that would allow us to bring our load down to 200, which is what I believe, well, I have to double check it, I was told today is where Falmouth is. They have 600 students, I'm told, and 3 guidance counselors. It would bring us a little bit less than where Greeley is right now, for example. I don't know what Greeley is planning to do next year. it would allow us, it would allow the guidance counselors to spend significantly more time with 9th and 10th graders. Right now, they touch base with 9th and 10th graders as best they can, and they have pieces of a plan of sort of a four-year career and post-secondary plan that they have for kids. But the truth is, there's not time to do a comprehensive, coherent, systematic look at what that should look like. So that's where the additional guidance counselor would pay off, because when the numbers come down in terms of what the counselors have to deal with, they can do a much better job of working with individual kids about post-secondary career planning, looking at this is what I'm interested in being, these are the post-secondary options that can lead me there, whether it's a four-year, two-year military job, whatever it is, they can do a much, much, much better job. They can also do, I think, a better job of sort of early intervention and identification of kids who are struggling, which is a problem that we've talked about. That I've talked to the board about, the board's talked to me about many times over the last, since I've been principal here. The pragmatic reality as well is we could get down to the numbers, closer to the numbers where Greeley found that those places are right now by just hiring a part-time counselor. That could be done. And that would allow us to continue to do what we're doing now and at the sort of level of quality that we're doing now. It doesn't allow us to better for the kids that we think we should be doing. But there's also a practicality, having been in schools that have part-time counselors in the past, it's a really inefficient way to run a guidance office. There are major access issues for parents, for kids, for the counselors, because you're always constantly having to match up schedules, and the constraints on that are very significant. And the bang for the buck that you get, hiring a full-time person as opposed to a part-time addition. It's a huge difference. So I can get some more information if the board is interested in the questions are that you have, but that's what I'm asking for. We need to add additional elective classes. We need to have additional slots for kids to fulfill their elective course requirements, and in some cases they're mandatory requirements. We can do that by increasing the number of sections of currently existing courses. But there are proposals to add two, and if we added new electives, it would still have the same implication in terms of our staffing increase request, similar to what I think Nancy was talking about in connection with the middle school staff increase. But there are suggestions for two classes to be added. One is to add Advanced Placement Biology, which is a new level of obviously a program that is already currently existing. We do not currently have any advanced placement courses in our science department. Every one of the other areas does have Advanced Placement Biology. I think it's one of the most commonly offered courses in schools across the country. We don't have it. It would be a junior year course that kids would take instead of their current biology course. The other course that we have a proposal for is art history. Again, we could not choose to do art history and do just that additional section of another elective, but we happen to have a staff member who has tremendous experience in art history, and it would give kids who aren't particularly attracted to studio art experiences, an opportunity to earn art credit in a quite different way. And it would be an unleveled course, anybody could take it, and I think it would have a lot of advantages. I am also hoping to be able to create, and I don't have a current, Pauline has been after me to create about Chapter 127 funds and that sort of stuff. I am hoping within that request that I've asked for, to be able to start to create a learning center where kids can come and get some additional help. Next year, regardless of what happens in Augusta this year, all of our incoming ninth graders will face learning results, graduation requirements in math, in English, in science, in social studies, and in health and PE. There are a significant number of other schools, that, in my experience, that do have what they call learning centers that are open all day where kids can come and get some assistance. I'm not looking to do that. We've been able to create, for kids who are in substantial need of assistance, particularly math, we were able to create a couple of additional courses in math, which kids double up. Our most struggling math students are now doubling up in math, and it's producing great results. But it does not address the need of the kid who, as you go through, you identify that they have specific gaps, areas where they're just weak. They're generally okay. They can take algebra and they can succeed in algebra, but they just have a real gap in some foundational piece of math knowledge, which if they were to be able to fill, then they would be able to demonstrate not only being more successful in math later on, but they would be able to demonstrate the proficiency in the math learning results. Math is just an example. The same thing would be true in social studies and writing and other places. And so a learning center would allow us to have kids who've identified as having very specific gaps to go for some intensive help for several weeks, a few weeks, 4 weeks, 6 weeks. I don't have a specific proposal for you tonight, but it's part of the proposal that I would sort of fold into the request for the additional teachers proportionate. I've been asked in the course of budget discussions a perfectly legitimate question about are there courses that we can eliminate that are low enrolled? And we have eliminated over the past couple of years a couple of courses like that. It's possible we'll eliminate some more where there's a trend over a period of 2-3 years where the enrollments have just gone down. We don't mind doing that. We look at it regularly, and that's perfectly fine. There are sort of three types of reasons why the high school periodically have classes in the neighborhood of 12 to 15. And in some cases, in a few cases, we have less. The most significant number of those courses are sections that have been created to assist students who are struggling so that they can get more individual teacher attention to provide the support they need. We've been able to have some smaller sections in our science classes, in our social studies classes. And this year we added one section of English as well for junior and senior students. And I think if you talk to our special education teachers or teachers, just anybody who's familiar with the struggles, there's a population that struggles. And so that's a significant number of kids, a significant number of sections they have. When you look at just the bare numbers, they don't tell the story. That's a big part of those classes. There are a few classes which are advanced classes, which because of this year, we have actually two science classes, our honors advanced physics class and our marine biology class, which for years have attracted 15 to 20 kids every year. This year, they're a little bit low. If they continue to be low over the next couple of years, we'll take a look at them. And I don't expect that will happen. I think for whatever reason, we have a bullet run. We always have some years for various reasons. But there are a few of those classes. And then the other most common reason why we would have classes that are 12 or 15 or whatever, and the question, the perfectly legitimate question is, why don't we push those up to 22 or 23 and that sort of thing, is because very frequently that's not the way things are presented. When you go to the schedule, you look at the number of kids who have signed up to take or been recommended to take. If we have, for example, a sign up of 30 for a class, and this happens all the time in a small school which tries to meet lots of needs of kids. If you have 30 kids, you have a choice of, do I create one large section of 30, or do I create two of 15, or even 27 or 28 kids, or 51 kids, do I create two sections of 25 and 26, or do I create a few small sections? That sort of question repeats itself constantly throughout the scheduling of the high school. And it's true in any high school, but it's more true of smaller high schools like this, which try to offer kids a lot of choices, which I think is why some education needs to be. So that's sort of my quick overview of where the high school is.
Jeff, I'm sorry, I didn't follow completely.
Yep.
Did you say that the teacher load target is 90, or the current teacher load is 90?
The school board range target is 80 to 90.
Okay.
Most of our teachers, particularly in the core area, well, most of our teachers across the board are higher than the 90.
Can you
I'd be glad to. I haven't looked at it for a little while. I think it's, we're in the 93, 94. So.
Okay.
Some teachers are considerably higher. There's some who would be a little bit lower, but on average,
okay.
I can bring those.
But some English teachers, too.
Yeah.
Over
100. Yeah, Wynn Phillips, I know, I think he leads the pack. I think he's got 106 students. When you think about, you know, we want kids to be able to write, and think about the burden of correcting all that, it's a lot of time. There are certainly schools that I know of. I've worked in one where English teachers teach four classes because of the demands of correcting writing, and because you want teachers to be able to conference with kids individually about their writing, which is one of the things I'd like to be able to see happen in a learning center, which I wouldn't be able to staff all day under this proposal, but I'd be able to open it probably at times, particularly when it would be easy to access ninth graders, would be my priority target population.
With respect to the guidance counselor, do you have any usage data on that? For instance, are those numbers hard numbers of actual contact? 275 is a lot, but are 275 people actually contacting each guidance counselor? Are there a number of people who just don't access, don't take advantage of that? So in other words, the number of contact hours is not as high.
I can get that in some pretty good detail for you. From what I know, 11th and 10th graders, 11th and 12th graders are contacted and meet with the guidance counselors individually multiple times in a year. 9th and 10th graders less so, and in 9th and 10th grade, a lot of the services are provided sort of in group settings. For example, I know the guidance counselors came in and they did a career inventory with kids, 9th graders, a couple months ago. There are some individual meetings with 9th and 10th graders. I don't have numbers for you right now, Richard, but I know that the individual time is right now heavily focused on 11th and 12th graders. 10th graders, to some extent, are on, and even PSA and PSAT interpretation is done in fairly large group settings. But I can get some real good
specifics. Because I would think as you move forward, of course, there'd be a more significant need to have the one-on-one. But at the earlier years, I mean, there's the ideal world and it's the fiscal reality. The fiscal reality is aggregate counseling may be the best model right now versus a model that ideally would be a one-on-one situation with the 9th and 10th graders. Have you ever experimented with a funnel system on the electives where you would take students in and just whoever wants to take them just can't take them? For instance, there would be an urgency, a group of students would be targeted as urgent, need to have them. Students would be targeted as priority, low priority, or does whoever gets there first gets into the elective?
We do that right now, actually.
The priority system?
Yeah. I mean, and most of our electives have waiting lists right now. Seniors are given priority.
Right.
Second semester seniors are particularly given priority,
yeah.
Where they have credit requirements. So that really already does exist. I mean, it's very difficult for 9th and 10th graders to get into any kind of art elective. Fundamentals, but it's almost impossible for them to take anything else.
There's one other question. It's a much more global question and maybe a little bit more esoteric. Do students understand what's going on in terms of the fiscal realities and what they would like to have is not always what's going to happen, and what the community would love to have is not going to happen? Or do they understand truly at the secondary level, perhaps more than any other level, that what would absolutely be desired may not happen, and so they've got to stretch and bend like a lot of community members are right now? Or should they even know about this process?
Yeah, I think it would be instructive for them to know about the choices that have to be made. My guess is that if I talk to them in the abstract, they would say, yeah, that makes sense, that they have to make choices too about what's important to them and that kind of thing. So I think in the abstract they would understand that. I think they'd even understand it in terms of the school. But they obviously still have academic needs. We still put certain requirements in front of them. The state puts learning results requirements in front of them. And the question is, if we're going to say that these are required things, then we've got to be able to make it available. And it's somewhat incredibly difficult. And particularly for the struggling students, if we say you are now subject to demonstrating proficiency in math, basically through the level of advanced algebra, which is what's happening in math, or science through biology, chemistry, and physics, we've got to have some supports in place to make it possible for them to do it, hopefully succeed. So I think probably in the abstract, yes. To be honest with you, I haven't had those discussions.
Excuse me, but just one more question.
Sure.
What's the impact of physical space with all what you're requesting in terms of where, how is this all, is there the impact on the physical facilities for what you're asking?
The high school
office
is
space.
No, nothing beyond what's been planned anyway. The high school is scheduled to have 4 portable classrooms and portables next year. So I'm not asking for any more than that. And then the schedule calls for the kindergartners to leave around February and that sort of thing, so that we can have some swing space for construction. But no, there's no real impact on space that would translate into any additional costs that are not already built in.
To go back to Richard's first question of related to contact hours, do we have any idea how much time is spent in college placement versus other guidance, which I would lump under the category of academic guidance, and of that portion that represents academic guidance, how much of that is available to freshmen and sophomores and juniors and seniors? You know, how does that kind of spin out? Because we're, one of the things I hear on a regular basis in the community is that our guidance department is really the college placement department, and that the kids who have academic problems are, not secondary intentionally, but can be secondary. And that may be an even more compelling reason, I think, for guidance. And combined with Richard's question about overall contact, I think that becomes, part of a package. I'm glad he brought that up because I hadn't considered that in the past.
I would be strictly guessing, but I can certainly get a...
I'm not asking you to answer that
right,
tonight.
Right, no, but I can certainly gather some information.
And I suppose one other thing, one other exercise that I would not want anybody to spend a huge amount of time on, but sort of a what if projection, and that would be, what if we have that X number of student increase, didn't hire a single additional teacher? What would that kind of do? Teacher loads, things like that. Because I think that's going to be a much starker contrast, knowing how difficult it is to wrap your arms around the high school schedule.
Well, I could certainly get that in terms of student load per teacher. I could project that.
Any other questions for Jeff? Then we can move on to district-wide. Pauline, are you going to do that, or Jerry?
Different people will be addressing the different issues on the district one.
Okay.
And the first one is the computer technician.
That's probably
that's you.
I just adding up some figures here, and between the schools and the town, I think we have over 900 pieces of technology, computers, printers, and all the other kinds of things that happen. Basically have staff, myself and 2 others, 3, so we're looking at a 300-to-1 ratio, which is kind of high. Business industries, I've heard anywhere figures from as low as 50-to-1 to 100-to-1, those kinds of things, so we're not going to get there, but it would be nice if we could get a little closer. There's also things happening statewide initiatives, Milby initiative, the laptop program, which has been a great benefit to the middle school, that may get extended to the high school, which would increase the load that we're dealing with. MEDEMS is the main educational data management system.
one of the technology coordinators we just met over the weekend, we were talking about all these statewide initiatives. He calls them the triple M's, Milty, Metams, and MEA Online, three things that we've been dealing with. But they're technology related, and they're taking some time out of our staff's time. They're doing some training Monday on MEA Online, because our eighth grade staff are going to be doing a piece of that one. All of these things are adding to our caseload. We are starting and moving towards a new student information system, PowerSchool, which is also an additional work involved. So with all that involved, we really need some additional technical help. That's why the bulk of the computer technicians.
So all the 7th and 8th grade laptops included in that 900 pieces number that you gave us?
Yes. And we do keep track of calls, or try to keep track of calls, and if we looked at, you know, a call is a trouble call, Tom can't print or something like that, and we log it into the database, and the calls have been growing each year. Last year, 2002-2003, we had 1,150 calls that we entered into our database, and I'm going to estimate, I didn't keep track of the Milty, the laptop stuff separately, and I didn't put it in there. I'm going to say 150 or better calls. So we're looking at probably 1,300 calls over last year. As of right now in our database, we have 762 calls in the regular stuff that we do, the town and school stuff, and 312 Milty calls. I kept keeping track of the laptop ones separately. So we got 1,074, and this is January. We had 1,300 total. Those are the kinds of things that we're dealing with. We're way behind. If we talk to these people, they'll be out throughout their buildings. We can't get to the stuff that is just physically on enough hours in the day and staff to deal with it. So we do our best.
Yeah,
what's the increase due to increased equipment, increased usage? What do you think?
Over the past 2 years, we've added 320 laptops just for students to our workload. So that, more equipment, plus the other initiatives that are requiring technology. There's a piece of technology involved with them.
So that would be more usage.
More usage. Okay.
And potentially, if the governor's proposal is somehow funded, we'd be adding how many computers in the high school? For students?
Whatever the freshman loan would be. There's 160 eighth graders right now.
There's a plus 160, and my understanding of the proposal
and
is
plus
that.
Plus that.
Well, that's where I'm headed. The entire faculty, not just ninth grade faculty. So.
I hear different stories all the time. So.
Well, that's what the actual proposal was, and again, that's all subject to funding. But, Jeff, so how many faculty members do we have?
Teachers would be about 50. If you include counselors and nurses and things like that, it'd be closer to 60.
So we're talking about another plus 200 laptops, 1,100 devices, roughly. And if you don't get a technician, what's your ratio?
Call it 1,200.
We'll be close, yeah.
We're 400, which is, so that's like 400% over what's common in the worst case in the private sector.
And that includes me in the picture, too, and do you want me out there?
Well, exactly.
If there are other kinds of things that need to be done to manage with the new SIS, and all these other kinds of things, too.
Is there also any kind of ongoing scheduled maintenance of the equipment? Preventive maintenance type things?
We try to do that. Some of that during the summer, like laptops are cloned, re-imaged over the summer, so that kind of stuff happens there. It depends. The staff, I'm off part of the summer, and vacations and things like that. We don't have a full staff to deal with all that we need to do.
So the lack of a comprehensive preventive maintenance program may in fact be adding to your woes?
Sure. And the other piece of this too that you need to realize is that we're a town school department, so we deal with probably, I'm going to guess, 75, 85 town computers as well.
Oh, that's not included in the 900?
That's included.
Oh, it is, okay. I thought it was.
And but there's a piece of the work that we do that's town.
No, I understand that. Do your trouble call statistics include the town?
Yes.
Okay.
Can I have to ask the obvious question, do we pay the entire budget?
No, the town picks up a percentage and a piece of our salaries.
That's almost $17,000 this current year put in the budget from the town.
Is there any reason to suggest that as these questions get answered, like my own life experience, that I won't be calling again because I've got my question answered? Or is there always somebody new on the horizon ready to ask the same question again? I mean, at what point do we reach a plateau of questions being asked?
There's always, technology unfortunately fails. There's always hardware issues that are happen as we move forward with new initiatives. There's new training that needs to happen. Ideally, we would hope that we could, you know, train staff, and some of the nitty-gritty stuff could be taken care of through training. But there's always a level where it needs to go up a notch when it comes to our department.
Any other questions for Gary?
Yeah, just again to piggyback on what Richard's asking. Do you make in your trouble call log, do you make any differentiation to look at trends and what kind of calls one might consider to be nitty-gritty stuff versus significant problems that we couldn't have any possible expectation that the user would be able to deal with?
Yeah, these calls are numbers. A call could be setting up a computer. Occasionally it might be a simple thing, but generally we don't put the nitty-gritty stuff in. It's if I have to go, if one of the technicians has to go to on-site and work with the user, or work with the computer, the device, the printer, that's what warrants a call. So some of these things that we answer on the phone and those kinds of stuff, or answer through an email, don't even get into the picture.
But that's still true enough a piece of your time.
Oh, sure.
Your available work time. Because, it does make sense that at least in terms of faculty, at some point, people will not be calling you to change a ribbon or No, I understand that, but that may not be the perception out there. That's why I'm asking the question, for the clarification.
But we also have people in each school that have the ability to answer a lot of questions and troubleshoot some things, correct, Karen?
So there are some kind of unofficial staff that are in labs that really, the main responsibility is to maintain the labs at both middle school. But the principals graciously let use them throughout the building, so at least it's a kind of a point person for building for common things.
I would say too, people have tried to use resources and be resourceful so that they can do that, because one of the things is sometimes it's quicker. And kinds of things. And just for clarification, also Gary's invention of the I-team, which if he had only cloned that term, the man would not be sitting here because he would be a wealthy individual. Nationally, they have taken that term for him, and he's done. But that was a Gary Lanois idea. They can help out with many things. So I think some of the times, one of the things I would want to be sure the public understood that this request is not for some of the real basic kinds of things. And with the I-team, some of the things that are beyond basic, certainly beyond my expertise, they really can help out with. And we do have staff dispersed that are really into that, that will help out. But there are some things that we will need to call in the technicians for, to help with. And I know with our laptops, as our current eighth grade laptops get rotated to our incoming seventh graders next year, this will be their third year of use, heavy use kinds of things. And most of us, I think if you're using a computer regularly and frequently, you realize it has to be changed every so often, and I think the life is 3 to 4 years, something like that. So we can just predict that there are going to be some issues with them that we are going to need assistance beyond our ability to quickly handle. But it is a good point for clarification.
And one thing that I might add to Gary, you know, and his staff of Ginger and Jason, I mean, in the past few weeks, I've been in the middle school in meetings with Gary and Bev Bisbee around this whole laptop issue. And in the course of an hour and a half to 2 hours, there are at least 3 or 4 kids who come in and interrupt Gary for issues that they might have with their laptops. So, you know, it's something that, I mean, and Gary's there, you know, so he can, some of the things he can take care of in 2 seconds, and other things he'll have to take their computer and look at it later. You know, but the point is it Gary that we need in the school answering those kinds of questions? I mean, and that's only been two or three times that I've been in the middle school, and I've seen that consistently each time that I've been there.
Gary, does the Apple offer any tech support themselves, or is it sort of, here's your laptops, have a good time?
Phone support.
Yeah, they do.
Which also takes, you know, some time.
But that phone support is, I mean, for you folks versus users could call them directly, there's not that option.
For the laptop project, they try to funnel it through the tech people mm-hmm. in the building. But for standard users for Apple equipment, there is a helpline.
I'm just wondering if that was an option for you folks to get some additional, you know, to take off some of the calls. But I guess what you're saying is no, not really.
I don't think so. I think our staff are, they would be more willing to talk to staff around them and students and get help that way. Generally, when it needs to be called and it's a big enough issue that they need somebody with some technical background.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Okay. Nurse?
Somebody was, Tom, were you addressing that?
Who wants a nurse?
I can use a nurse.
I'll go first because I'll tell you the little bit that I know about it, and then my colleagues at the high school in Plum Cove can fill in with the harder part. I figure if I do the opening paragraph, if I can remember this, because they sent us a proposal, which I don't believe I have with me, but it's really to get so that each one of our schools would have a full-time nurse, and that with different student medication needs. See, I'll talk while they hunt for the paperwork. With different students with medication needs that need to be supervised, with different students with just other health issues and things that they're dealing with, that to have someone on site in each building is something that today's world has actually required. And right now, in the middle school, we do have a full-time nurse, but she also teaches for us, and she works as an advisor. We would continue that outlay in the middle school. It works for us, and it's a way for her to get to know students. She teaches a health class to the fifth grade. It's wonderful having her in that capacity. They all get to meet her throughout the year. They're going to be working with her for 4 years. It serves many purposes. She's a qualified health instructor. Plus, it's a nice way for the kids to get to know her. It fits in with the natural flow of things. Something doesn't have to be wrong with you, but you get to meet the nurse. So that works for us, and we would keep that. But at Pond Cove and at the high school right now, they share a nurse. She's down here some of the time, and at the high school, I mean, she's at the high school summertime in Pond Cove. And with the kindergarten coming back to Pond Cove, I think part of the proposal was they would have a large enough student body there with issues that they would have people there. They were also hoping that might help out with some of the other instructional needs that they have around health and other issues, things that they've been trying to get for years. And that the high school students have some issues where they need to have a health provider here on site. There are 2 support personnel that work in the health division. Right now, a person is at Pond Cove and one at the high school. The one at the high school comes up and helps with some clerical work in the middle school for 4 hours a week, I believe. In their proposal, they have designed that so that the person who's at Pond Cove would actually come over to the middle school and help with some medications and other kinds of clerical work, and the high school person would be more stationed down here as this population increases. And gentlemen, that's what I remember from reading that report a while ago. So now I will yield the floor to my colleagues.
There is a report, and I'm amazed that Nancy remembers as much as she did. The way it pans out, it looks like, from looking at the report, it's actually a request for an increase of a part-time nurse position at the high school. So that the current nurse who is shared between, between the high school and Pond Cove would go to Pond Cove and spend her time there. Then there'd be the nurse at the middle school, and then there would be a new position, which is a 24-hour position for a nurse at the high school. So that's the actual increase, as I understand it from here, but I haven't talked to Paula for quite a long time that this be requested. So that in the high school, it wouldn't actually be a full-time nurse in the high school. It would be more than we currently have.
Can you tell us about what kind of licensing requirements? I mean, are we talking about registered?
It's an RN.
It's an RN. And it is, they have to be licensed, and they have to be licensed by the state. And then if they do other things, they also have to be certified. Like our nurse happens to be a certified guidance counselor as well, too, as well as a health educator, and she has a license as a nurse, so she can serve all those wonderful capacities.
Both of our nurses now are certified by the state in the teacher division as well as nurses.
Before you continue, Jeff, just to put things in context for myself, you're talking about the middle school, Julie Salikas.
That's correct.
Who are we talking about sharing between Pond Cove and
Carrot Lake?
Yeah.
Paula.
It is Paula. Okay. And Barbara is?
She's a health aide.
Health aide who's at the high school, but she also spends time.
She comes up, I think it's about 4 hours a week, and helps with clerical work from the nurse's office, health records, all those kinds of things, and covering the nurse's office a bit of the time when Julie's out in the classroom.
So she's FTE? Full-time equivalent?
Yes, I believe.
Yes.
So just did what I need. And can she dispense medication? Other than Tylenol?
If they're trained.
Yes, okay. I believe she can.
I believe she can.
Yes.
I believe that she can.
She does.
Be trained, yeah.
She's not anywhere near a registered nurse.
She's not a registered nurse, no.
Technically, she's
LPN?
No.
I believe she's hired as a health technician.
She's a secretary, technically.
She's a secretary.
That's where I'm going.
Jeff, the nurse, the 24-hour, that's this position, 24 hours a week.
Yes.
Would that nurse also be teaching or doing other things in the high school? Or just their functioning as the school nurse?
I think Paula has ambitions of being able to get in a little bit into classrooms, but my impression from her is that that's not a significant piece of the proposal. I have to talk to her.
Wait a minute, I thought Paula was going to Pond Cove.
For the position.
Oh, okay. Oh, you mean Paula would have this component.
But Paula then would have the opportunity to do that at Pond Cove to help with the health.
Actually, Jeff, the one I have does call for full-time RN at the high school.
Great. Does work.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's not a date on this.
Yeah.
Which one is that the latest one?
I would hope so. It is the only one that I have.
Okay. I will take it back.
So, and I noticed on our overview here, it was listed as a full-time position. So that's why when I remembered reading this, it did come out. Then they've done some things with the two health aides that where they're, the person who's currently at Pond Cove would be at Pond Cove some of the time and give 5 hours a week to the middle school, Barbara Cummings, who's currently at the high school, would be mostly at the high school, but she'd give 10 hours at the middle school.
Can we move on to the custodian?
Well, is there any, again, like other positions, is there some data that shows usage, some data suggests that there's, other than just the popping in and saying hi.
Right, I believe it's all here, which I'm sorry, I have not committed to memory, but they have written, this is a 5-6-page proposal.
Okay.
They have a lot of that information.
This is still really amorphous to me. I don't understand what's happening with this nurse position.
Right, and they have a whole page here of different duties, including their correspondence with special education.
Okay.
So I think probably if you had a copy of this, you'd have a clearer explanation.
Nancy, do any of us have a copy of that?
I don't know.
Not tonight.
I don't believe you do tonight.
Richard, they have data similar to Gary's, too. Number of student contacts, 504 meetings attended, classes taught.
I believe this will be in your budget package, I'm assuming.
I would imagine we get that in our book, correct?
What I would imagine.
Okay. Custodian.
I'd like to put out it too. I'd like to have it before the budget book.
I'll make sure Pauline did it because it's a district wide, it really doesn't belong to
Anyone else. No, exactly. I'm just commenting generally.
No, because I think Tom would have probably been able to, answer all of these questions. So we can speak to him. Custodian?
I'll give you a little history on the custodians. What our request is here is we currently have two custodians who work school year only. They do not work during the summer, and they do not work during school vacation. What we're asking is to bring these two custodians to full-time, meaning they would work 52 weeks out of the year full-time. Over the past 5 or 6 years, it's been a process of bringing, we had at least 5 or 6 custodians who were only school year. And over the last 5 or 6 years, we've brought them to a full-time position because the need is there during the summer and during school vacation. So these are the last two that are still school year, and we'd like to bring those to a full-time position. So as people who have been here a while can remember that we've been doing this over the last few.
Pauline, what do you foresee them doing during the summer that isn't being done currently by the staff?
What we've done for maybe the last 3 or 4 years, we've used the money that we get through rentals of the building. Every spring, every May or June, I come to the Finance Committee requesting the use of those funds to hire custodians for the summer work. And we've been lucky the past few years to have some money there to be able to do that.
Well, would you anticipate this actually being revenue neutral? I mean, if we're using income now to pay for it.
We can't guarantee the rental money from year to year.
Well, that's a given, but I mean, are we going to apply rent receipts for this $15,000 before we apply it to anything else?
That was not my plan on doing that because we don't know if we will have $15,000 in rent from year to year. We can estimate a revenue and budget that every year.
I'm just thinking, what's the revenue history been?
What did we receive last year?
Yeah, I'm not asking for the answer tonight.
Right.
But what I'm saying is, what's the, is it average $15,000 a year? Is it average $5,000 a year? Because my inclination would be to dedicate rent revenue to this as a first, and then fund the difference, the average difference between the two.
Mm-hmm. Because I think that's what we've been doing every year.
Yeah, exactly.
Right, and the year, I think this past year was $16,000 or $17,000, but we have had some large rents. Leslie College has come in. I don't know how long we can count on that money coming in. A few years ago, we rented the cafetorium during the summer, and that went away.
We had St. Bart's rented the school for all of their church services. That was at the same time we had this summer educational institute here.
Mm-hmm.
So those years, we generated more money, but the standard year would be anywhere from, I'd say, 14.
Well, if that's the standard year, then we've almost got that nut at 14,000.
Well, that's because every year somebody has come on board. It may not be forever. Now, I think one of the things that happened last year is we had Leslie, we have Leslie again this year.
if we don't have Leslie next year, you can, and we don't replace them with somebody else, you can see that amount drop very quickly.
By at least half.
Yeah, so.
Well, I'm just thinking that if that, you know, in that worst case scenario, that's why God created it.
It looks right now like Leslie will be asking for another 2-year contract, but that's not for sure yet.
The other custodial issue is that next February, when the Pond Cove addition opens, we will be in need of additional custodial help for that part of the building.
When you get over and beyond these?
Yes, over and beyond those.
But that's a temporary situation?
No.
Pauline, I have a question. If we are subbing out summer care now, why do we not continue doing it that way versus, I'm just asking because I don't know, why are we changing what we're doing instead of hiring summer help? Why are we making this these two full-time equivalent employees?
Because we would like those individuals to work the summers and also have school vacations. Currently, we don't replace those individuals during school vacations. So no one is there in that section of the building. So we would like to have those people there during vacations, and then we could count on them during the summer. So currently, some individuals have been willing to work summers. Some have worked only 30 hours. They're not obligated to work for us during the summer.
So as far as we know, these two individuals would be considered capable and would also want those
additional
time?
We would open up the two positions as full-time, and hopefully our current employees would apply.
In the way it is now, they're not required to work summer. It's optional because they're really on a school year only contract.
Okay.
So they're more or less calling the shots as to how many hours they'll work in the summer.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not really having the right to mandate that because they are school year only employees. So
okay.
Pauline might say, we want you to work 40 hours this summer. And they say, well, I only want to work 20 or 30. And that's their prerogative at this point. If it becomes a year-round position, then it would be put out there as a year-round position. They wouldn't have the option to say, I'm going to work 30 hours or I'm going to work.
Thank you.
Under the current contract, don't they have first call on overtime work, summer work, vacation work?
Yes, they do.
Okay. So
well,
we would have to offer the to them first.
I mean, we do because
under the current system,
they're just right. There are employees we would have rather have them work in the buildings.
I mean, my questions are not related to whether or not so much the positions are necessary as to how to pay for them or pay for the increment. And you know, my question becomes, because I never get involved in this, are we charging essentially market rate for rental of facilities, or, you know.
Some people think we're getting over the market rate, but
I'm
just
sure
revised
do.
The use of school and town facilities.
Right.
And we had a committee cross-section of both town and school employees. We looked at what we were charging in the past. We compared it with what other communities were charging. We want to be fair, but we don't want to price ourselves out of the market.
Absolutely.
Because these tax, we wanted, the philosophy is to have these buildings be available 7 days a week and be available to the community at a cost where we can recoup some of the cost to maintain them, et cetera. So those fees have been presented to the town council, and they have been approved by the town council. Actually, that new facility policy went into effect on January 1. Now, as far as the school board is concerned, it's in the school board policy, all it says is there will be a use of facility policy, and what it is for, it's a guideline on the school side. And so if you haven't received new copies, you should be receiving them.
Does anyone else have any questions?
does all the income from the rental receipts of the schools come back into our budget?
Not all of it. The way the budget is set up now, that is done by community services, all of the scheduling of all the facilities, and as an arrangement for us to do it and to have a person do it, community services recoups 25% and the school gets 75%. And that is after there's a rental fee, and then there's usually a custodial fee. There also may be a supervisor fee. Those are added on to the rental fee, so that does not come out of that 75% take that the school gets on. Mm-hmm.
I have one more question. I'm still not clear on what the custodial staff is doing in the summer if the amount of usage of the building is considerably less than it is September through June.
During the summer, this is when they do their major cleanings. They would strip floors in classrooms. They wash the walls, wash the furniture, do that type of work that they cannot do during when school is in session.
One custodian has the skill of being a professional painter as well, and we utilized him in that capacity last year. So, and with vacations, there are a fair number of our custodians that have been here 20 years, they get 4 weeks vacation. So you also have to deal with the vacation schedules in the summer. So you almost never have a full crew. And they're right down to the wire. When school is going to start, we are, you know, we barely make it. Sometimes we think we're not gonna make it, we always do, but in order to do that, they skimp at the end. They miss some pieces that they really aren't able to do, so.
It's always a juggling act in the end of August to get everything ready for school to begin. I just wanted to touch on one more thing that Kevin brought up about using the rental to offset this cost. Because we are going to need an additional, I would say, part-time custodian once the Conco building is open. I was hoping to, if this goes through, then I was hoping to use the rental money from this current year to offset that cost of the custodian from February to June, because that will be a cost that I don't think we can get away from when the new section opens.
You and I can have our own conversation about that.
Volunteer coordinator?
I really don't know the number.
Were you going to speak on that?
About the marriage?
The volunteer coordinator, Gail's position. Gail is requesting to go. Gail Schmader is our volunteer coordinator, and she is currently working full-time, but we budget 75% of her time in the regular budget, and 25% is paid by the Escapade program. And I don't know much about the Escapade, but Claire or Tom knows what she does for the Escapade program.
The Escapade program is an after-school program that was first called funded by a grant. The grant was written by parents of children with disabilities, and the purpose of the grant was to allow their child to participate in after-school activities that are not school-sponsored, but are within the school community. And this allows a mentor to be with their child, to go to those, so that the student is able to participate. And we made it clear that it was not a school activity, because if it is, like for example, if they have art pride, if it was a school-funded, a school-sponsored activity, and I have a student that needs to go to them, and it's part of the curriculum, and if that child needs to have an adult with him or her, then special education is responsible to provide that staff. Okay? But for other activities that are not part of the school curriculum, some of the students in the community were not able to access it. So they wrote a grant, and part of the grant funding paid for Gail to oversee. And by Gail, from what I heard in talking with Tom, is that Gail is asking the school committee, the school, to pick up that portion that the grant is no longer maybe able to fund.
So is the excavator program finished?
No.
The grant paying for it.
The Rotary Club, we hope to fund 3 years of it.
The funding that the escapade has obtained doesn't only go to pay for Gail's salary. It has been used to have functions for students on Friday nights, for example. They've had, you know, bowling parties and whatever. So
this is for Gail's salary, correct?
Right.
For the escapade program?
Which she was, from what I've heard from Tom.
It didn't come to me. Tom
Purcell, but I'm looking at you to see if you had some input too. From what I've heard when, in a casual conversation, she was asking to have her salary picked up through the school budget.
Because I have this room, this can I jump in? I'm sorry.
I know, so long.
It's the Cape Community Coalition, okay, that built escapade. All right. It was the Cape Community Coalition that that put that together based on volunteers. It's the Cape Community Coalition, I believe, that is the sponsoring organization for the grant money. And it is the Cape Coalition, I believe, that was behind the escapade group soliciting funds from local organizations such as Rotary, Lions Club, things like that. How did Gail Schmader get a salary out of this? It's just a question.
It's a fair question, which we may not have the answer to tonight.
Right. And if you remember, and there may be several of us that remember, several years ago,
right.
I mean, this has been a proposal that has come for several years.
To increase her salary.
To increase her position to full-time.
To the best of my recollection, it was never presented as a function of escapade.
No, you're correct about that. So why don't we wait and we can have that conversation?
Well, basically what I'm saying is I need more information.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I don't think we're going to have it tonight.
No.
So, all right.
And I'm not asking for it.
Okay. K-12 Chapter 127 support, what is that?
I think that's there.
Did you say it?
That's not
127, Chapter 127 is the number associated with learning results, but that's not part of my...
This year, even I know this one. This one
Tom knows.
I don't know it.
I'm not sure about the total.
About
we had to come with the total.
That's
I know we
the
had,
summer.
Or, yeah, but I think Jeff might know the proposal too. We had talked about identifying and helping kids throughout the system to help them meet the learning results. One of the proposals would be for the district to fund the summer literacy program that we had last summer. It was done through a grant, through the foundation grant. So the proposal would be, since it's been done once, was very effective, and we're going to need it, is to have it in the school budget. And I think our discussion was it would come under this heading as a K through 12 support network for kids. So I think the $2,500 there is for the Ponco piece. But Jeff and Nancy must have other ideas.
Well, I think actually a big, I think
talking about the nursing guy, he did well with the
I think probably the rest of it is, I think the bulk of it last year was dedicated to the high school, and it really paid for, and continues to pay for, the creation of the two sections of main learning results math, which Elaine Brownell and Charlotte Hanna are teaching right now. And those are the courses which for our most struggling students, when we identify by the MEAs and standardized testing and teacher recommendations and things, those are the courses that we say to parents and say to kids, this is some additional support that you're going to have in math in order to have a chance of getting to some portion of advanced algebra, which is where the learning results say that kids need to be in order to be successful. So that's what that money is at this point.
Is that a summer math program to identify that, or is that incorporated during the school
year?
It's
during the school year. Those are classes that kids take either for an entire semester or school year, depending on what their particular goals are and what their progress has been in the school.
So you actually separate them out of your general high school budget?
Yep.
So then how would it be identified where it would go when it says K through 12?
Well, last year, I don't know. I mean, I think that's really, last year was the first year this was here, really. And the high school was made a priority, although Concord got a part of it. But the high school was made a priority because coming into this year, it appeared that, as far as we know, it's still the case that our ninth graders were subject to the mean learning results law. And so we had to put in place something that would give it, and we knew that math was going to be, even though our kids in math, overall, on average, do outstandingly well compared to the rest of the state. In fact, that's what we just got awarded a recognition for at the last school board meeting. We still have a number of kids who struggle in math. And so the decision was made, and it was almost an obvious thing to do last year, was to target math for the use of that money so that we could create those courses. And the school board members who have been here for a while remember that it was sort of a 2 years ago, Charlotte Hanna, one of our math teachers, wrote a grant through the Cape Elizabeth Education Foundation to purchase a piece of software called Accelerated Math, which has been an incredibly invaluable tool that she had tremendous success with that year, and that this year we sort of built on that success by creating those double-up math courses that some kids are taking. So that's what that means.
Pauline, do you recall how much we put into the budget for that last year?
For salaries, it was approximately $23,000, and software was $13,000. And that was under a separate department,
right.
And it was called Chapter 127 Support.
And do we know how that wound up being spent?
Well, it's being spent by the salary as a teacher.
Teacher salary for teaching two classes, and the purchase of the software.
All right, so that accounts for everything?
Yes.
Yes, and this $2,500 is an additional request under the Chapter 127.
Okay, that's what I was missing. This is an increase to that.
Correct.
We're not just asking for $2,500.
No, I still have in there.